Now that we know how to write the equilibrium expression for a given equation, we're going to practice calculating the equilibrium constant when we're given values. So again, we're going to be working with our decomposition of N2O4 equation. And in a series of tables, I'm showing various information. So notice here, the first two columns of our five trials are showing initial concentrations of our two substances. So notice we're alternating what we're starting with N2O4 in the first one. Notice NO2 is zero. In the second one, I'm starting with NO2 back and forth. And then notice in the fifth one, I'm actually starting with both substances. So again, equilibrium will be reached no matter what I start with in this reaction. Now I can't use those values to calculate equilibrium because they are initial. I would have to use equilibrium quantity. So these next two columns are showing, once the system comes to equilibrium, how much of each substance do I have in the container? Realize for this chapter, our goal is to build up to you being able to determine what the amounts for substances will be at equilibrium. So we'll get there. We'll build up to that. For now, I'm telling you how much we have at equilibrium. So on the next slide, I'm going to work through the practice of calculating our first Kc value. And after I calculate that one, I'll encourage you to practice on trials 2 through 5. And so again, in order to calculate a value for Kc, I need to know my expression. And again, because it's a K, it's implied that these can only be used once the system has reached equilibrium. And for the first trial, we were told that NO2 has a concentration of 0.0125 molar, and that is squared, whereas N2O4 has a concentration of 0.0337 molar, and that is first order. When we plug these values in, our calculator spits out a value of 0.0046365, keeping some extra digits in there. So two things to discuss. One is sig figs. Realize that since both of my values go to 3 digits, I'm going to report my final answer here to 3 digits. This number could be written in decimal notation. It's not terribly small, so decimals are fine. Or I can write it in scientific notation. Both of these numbers are equivalent. The next thing to discuss are units. So notice here that I have units of molarity in both of these. But with equilibrium, this is based on a law of mass action. It's basically describing that when I compare or when I measure my equilibrium quantities, I'm comparing those to standard values. So if you remember from first semester, standard quantities for concentrations of 1 molar, for pressures would be 1 atmosphere, and temperature would be 25 degrees Celsius. So I'm comparing each one of these to its standard quantity. Of course, dividing by 1 won't change the value, but the net effect is that my units will cancel out for each one. And so same thing in the denominator. I'm dividing by a value of 1, which won't change the numerical quantity, but my molarities cancel out. And so key thing to remember for any equilibrium constant is that they are always unitless. So again, regardless of what subscript we put on here, if I was measuring or calculating a Kp, it's also unitless. As we get into our acid-base chapter, we change the subscripts. Any K value is always going to be unitless. And so two options. One is when you're showing your work, you can just leave the molarity out so that you can remember that it will cancel. Or you can include it, but just remember that those units will cancel when you go to report your final answer. So again, I will encourage you to practice trials 2 through 5, calculating your KC value. Go ahead and pause the video because the next slide I'm going to show the answers and discuss them. All right, so I assume that you calculated trials 2 through 5. Noticing once we do that, that even though we started with a variety of concentrations and substances initially, notice that our KC values, we'll look at all of these here, our KC values are relatively constant. So again, the key to understanding equilibrium and our values here is that the KC value is constant as long as my temperature is constant. Sure, we have a little bit of variation in this last digit in these numbers, but that's due to rounding and how many digits we could actually measure here. But they're all really close to each other, and so this is considered to be a constant value. So again, at a given temperature, the ratio of my products to reactants for a given reaction will always be constant. For those of you who are visual, the table on our previous slide can be represented graphically. So the left graph is showing initial concentrations. The blue is N2O4. So when I started with that, the orange is the NO2. So when we just started with that, notice in this last trial, we started with both. The right table or graph is showing our values for our equilibrium concentrations, again, using this as our average KC value. What we should recognize is that although our values are different, the ratio of products to reactants is roughly the same in each one. If I have a little bit more reactants, I have a little bit more products, and vice versa.